Hey there, welcome back. Today we're going to be doing something a little bit different. Most of the times I have been doing illustration process videos. This time, still illustration, still a time lapse, but we're actually going to take a look at the design work that I have done for a current short film in progress called Paladan. Lots of work, lots of preliminary stuff. I'll have more behind the scenes kind of stuff like this, just design explorations and background work, all that stuff, in future videos. But this is really the birth of a character. So if you're not subscribed, go ahead and subscribe now so you can see more of the stuff from this character in the future. But without any further ado, let's hop into the drawing. Yeah, so as I said, this is going to be a little bit different because it's not one single illustration that I am working from start to finish, but rather a character design exploration for Paladin. Paladin is a short film for now, hopefully maybe a series in the future, about a knight in shining armor, so to speak. Maybe not so much armor, more chainmail, because armor is really cumbersome to draw, who knew? But it is, in essence, a knight on a quest to save people. The catch is that he's not actually out to save everybody. He has one specific person that he's trying to save. But his sword has been possessed by a fey spirit who wants to be worshipped as a big G god. So in order to do that, he figures he needs a paladin going around and spreading the news of his good works, just like every other god does. So it leads to lots of hijinks. These are early explorations on the screen right now, where I liked the chainmail hood. That actually stays. But initially, I was just going to have him with kind of a belt and just kind of an amorphous, like, white knight kind of, like, cloth over chainmail kind of look, and a cloak. And I think initially this was a really cool idea. I really do like how these started out. Lots of movement in this design, lots of simple shape language. Easy to animate because a lot of it is based on spheres, but the cape was cumbersome, didn't want to keep doing that. And also the shape language was a little too round. And as you study shape language more, you get a feel for what is more heroic, more menacing, more friendly and sweet, and round shapes can really take the edge off of a character. And I knew that this character was not just good, not just a happy guy. He has kind of a dark backstory. He's kind of forced into being the good guy, the White Knight. And so he needed to have a little bit more edge, a little bit more sharpness to him. So now we get in to the other explorations, where I'm really starting to dig into some more shapes that get into the idea that as soon as you see this character appear on screen, there's a little bit more hardness to the character than might first be assumed just from the demeanor of the character. Lots of different things. I kind of stick to this trapezoid shape, this tapered trapezoid for the torso, the top of the body. And work through that a number of times. And Procreate glitches a couple of times and you'll see drawings just appear out of nowhere. But, you know, you can see me figuring out how flat do I want to make that shape? How much do I want to taper to actual muscles and bone structure and all that stuff? This last drawing here, kind of off to an angle, is probably the closest that I get. That is to how I draw the character now. The early drawings, you can see the hood is kind of framing the entire face, and it's not until these later drawings on the bottom that I really start to get the shape of the chin involved, and that really helps the character stand out. I think it looked kind of goofy where it was just like just peeping out of a hood like this, and then, you know, just figuring out how the tabard kind of sits underneath the belt, where the belt should sit. Really, generally, I like it to sit high so that it frames the chest area and just kind of take up where that midriff might be normally. And once I've got these kind of shapes together, this kind of curved rectangle for the head, it's nice and sharp, but it's not too rigid. I start kind of trying to get the character in motion, like this character walking right here. and trying to figure out some profiles, him walking. This is kind of what maybe a mid-walk cycle look would be. And, you know, I've got some kind of front and three-quarter views already. Figuring out how he's going to look from the side view is really going to solidify those shapes. And going back to this one right here, you can see that I'm kind of sticking with that kind of half circle for the construction of the body. It's just after I've already drawn that I really try and break it down into something more like that straight tapered kind of trapezoid triangular look. Now, the thing about this character is that his patron, his fae spirit that wants to be a recognized god, is not as powerful as the regular god. So instead of having a majestic steed, the most that his patron can muster is a hobby horse, which is really the conceit of Paladin. He is a paladin, his name is Dante, but to really kind of drive the knife in, twist it a little bit more, and make him a little bit more humiliated by all of this, he's Paladin. He's not his full name, just Dan. Something very undignified, very not majestic. And riding the hobby horse is totally summed up in one image. That picture of him on the hobby horse is really the entire timbre of the show. This, unfortunately, I lost so much of the recording. The cockatrice is the first enemy that he fights, and I really, really, really love how that came out. The stupid wall-eyed look is so funny. But, you know, once I have gotten a nice hold on the feel of how the character should look and how I want the character to be portrayed, the next challenge is knowing that I'm going to have to animate this character. I'm going to have to draw it a lot of different ways, with a lot of different poses, and not just like comic poses, like passing poses. So how do the shapes that make up the body really translate in all of these different situations? So I try to go for some extreme action shots. Now, grain of salt here. A lot of this character exploration was really done before I was doing a ton of reference gathering before I do these poses, so a lot of these are not super solid. I have learned since then to love reference in a way that I have never. For a long time, I didn't know how to use reference properly, so using reference to get this character looking the way that I wanted to was foreign to me and would just get in the way of me actually doing the work of deciding how the character should look. But I'll have a video on that up soon about how to use reference to effectively draw inspiration and build out your characters. But from this point, you know, I have a number of art of books for shows that I really enjoy. All of them, for any character design, is going to have an expression sheet where you go through and design the expression, the way that this character expresses themselves. So just trying to hit a range of emotions here that are probably going to be pretty common to use for this character. And, you know, I've got a couple of cool, like these two, the one that's diving up on the top left, the one where he's in the curled fetal position. That's actually intended to be something where he's kind of cannonballing through the air. But, you know, I've got a couple of different things. There's the kind of suspicious on the top right. There's the grimace right below that, kind of a smug smile to the left of that. Below that one is more of a front-on anger, kind of an interested look. And I have kind of the closed eyes look for him. So really designing just the way that the character is going to maintain those design elements, like the closed eyes and these different expressions. You know, how am I going to keep that look, keep it simplified, because the rest of the design is pretty simplified, but still maintain it from this interested, this like broad mouth, this yelling look, this kind of, I guess, moping look beside that, and then the very jovial head tilt smile, like all of these things, the way that the face is gonna squash and compress and stretch in certain ways. You know, I also have decided for the most part that except for a full profile, the silhouette of that hood will not be broken. Even if the hood goes right up to the line, I didn't want to have like any brow ridges or any cheekbones or anything like that breaking the silhouette of the hood. And that's a design choice. One, to keep it simpler for me to animate, but two, because I think that's kind of a cool, like, the silhouette is just very defined, that kind of rectangular tube of the head. And doing a profile view of that dive downwards to kind of get a better idea of what's going on there in actuality, and then kind of an at the ready with the sword and trying to do a kick. Again, learn how to use reference, guys. It is such a good tool. A lot of these are a little stiffer than I would like because I didn't use reference to get a handle on how it might actually look. Bygones being bygones, I've had to use it since then, so it all comes out in the wash. But you can get a much better early reference sheet if you just learn to embrace the reference. So, you know, really, really diving in on what works for that specific character. Now, moving on to this bit, his patron is like a forest deity that Dante encounters on his travels. His name is Twiggeran. And I recall, maybe I was playing a Zelda game at the time, but really kind of digging into that kind of stylistic element. And again, looking for strong shape language that I can keep really simplified. I knew I wanted, since he is a forest entity and a little bit more mischievous, I wanted it to be slim, slender, kind of lanky, something a little bit slippery to an extent. And I think that comes across with his initial design sheet. And like a lot of this stuff, I hadn't drawn these characters before. I just had to really sit, visualize, and figure out, okay, what am I going for? Who is this character? And I had written some stuff for these guys already as well, which is super helpful. When you're doing character designs, do some writing exercises for them first, or get someone to write something for you so that you can really hone in on what are their primary traits? What are the defining elements of this character that need to be conveyed visually? And that's something that I learned when I went to conventions and talked to character designers for Disney and DreamWorks and Pixar. Their biggest thing is go to the literature, go to the source material, what was written for these characters, and figure out how to convey what these characters are about through shapes, through design choices. And, you know, like I said, the initial designs for Paladin were just too round, too soft, and that didn't really convey the hardness that this character has to him. The same with Twiggeran. He is supposed to be a good character. He wants to be a good, like, paladin patron, but he's mischievous and troublesome and, you know, all of these things. He tricked a guy into being his paladin, tried to possess him, but wound up possessing his sword instead. So that's not like a strictly lawful good thing to do. So you want those elements to be apparent before the character even speaks. And, you know, now I'm finally getting to the point where it's like, okay, I've done enough sketches. Let's try and tie down some line work and see how it looks in a more rendered piece. I admit, especially at this point in time, I've gotten better at it since. I'm not the greatest at rendering fully, like doing full paintings or visual development pieces like that. It's a totally different skill set that you have to learn over time, just like you do with drawing, period. But doing these more tied down drawings really helps you commit and get over the sketchy lines and the shape explorations and decide, okay, this is what we're doing. And then doing an alternate costume, I had some pretty strong ideas of what would be happening in the future with the character, and there would be a point in time where he might be a little bit more covert, more incognito, and that's where this comes in. Still trying to keep with like that kind of castle parapet design on the hood, or on the shawl, I guess, that would still read as like, oh cool, this is a medieval character, but stay within the shape language of the main character. And that's really the primary thing that I was looking for designing Paladin. Building out this guy who's got kind of a dark backstory, but he's playing the good guy. This is, it's been a passion project for a while now. It's turning out to be like a 6 or 7 minute pilot short thing. Stick around, I'll post maybe some animation tests, I'll post some more design work that I've done for the show, for other characters that aren't in the first episode, maybe some writing stuff. If you are interested in that, go ahead and maybe subscribe down at the bottom, stay tuned for future videos on this in the future, and hopefully I'll see you around. See you next time.